As we journey through the corridors of time, it's imperative to acknowledge a profound truth that often eludes our daily consciousness. Time is indeed moving, and with each passing moment, we are all aging, inching closer to our inevitable judgment day. In the heart of human nature lies a reluctance to acknowledge this inevitability. We immerse ourselves in the day-to-day, often pretending that the horizon of our existence stretches infinitely. Yet the truth remains. We are all aging, and our time here is finite. This is not a morbid fixation, but a stark reality that should guide our actions, decisions, and priorities. The scriptures remind us, Hebrews 9:27, "It is appointed unto men once to die, but after this the judgment." This poignant verse highlights the inescapable truth of our existence. Death is a certainty, and following it, a divine reckoning. Despite this, there's a tendency among us to live as if we are exceptions to this rule, to deceive ourselves into believing that the end is always a day too far to concern us. This undeniable fact of life signals us to pause and reflect deeply on the essence of our existence and the priorities that govern our lives. In the motion of life, where distractions abound and the noise of the world drowns out the whispers of eternity, the call to live a life anchored in loving God and communion with Him stands as a beacon of true purpose and fulfillment. Yet, in the pursuit of this paramount relationship with our Creator, we encounter a formidable adversary within ourselves, the propensity to deceive ourselves. This self-deception is a subtle art, finely woven into the fabric of our human nature, leading us to believe that we are living lives focused on fellowship with God, when in reality, we may be far from it. It's a mirage of spiritual complacency, where the rituals of religion are observed, but the heart remains distant from the divine embrace of our loving Father. Do not live a deceived life. Do not live a life of deception. Be honest with yourself. The Bible teaches us that Jeremiah 17:9, "The heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who can know it?" This stark biblical truth challenges us to undertake a journey of introspection, to peel away the layers of self-deception that may have enveloped our hearts. It's a call to honesty, to a ruthless, merciless examination of our inner selves, questioning whether our lives truly revolve around God as the epicenter of our existence. In a world captivated by the transient and the temporal, the thought of death and the eternal consequences of our earthly sojourn are often relegated to the peripheries of our minds. We live in an age where the urgency of the eternal is drowned out by the immediacy of the now, where the pursuit of material success and personal gratification often eclipses the pursuit of spiritual richness and divine fellowship. Yet, the sobering reality remains. Time is relentless, and death, the great equalizer, awaits us all. How then shall we live in the shadow of this impending reality? The answer lies not in a life of fear and trepidation, but in a life of purposeful pursuit of a deep personal relationship with God.
God made man so that we can fellowship with him. Leviticus 26 verse 11 and 12. "And I will set my tabernacle among you, and my soul shall not abhor you. And I will walk among you, and will be your God, and ye shall be my people." The man wasn't the only thing God made. God made the beasts of the earth. God made the birds in the sky. God made the fish of the sea. God made all the angels that are in heaven. Of all these things that God made, He said that he will be God to human beings. If you look through the scriptures, God did not say this to the angels. God did not say this to the archangels. Michael is a great angel who has done so many things. He confronted and defeated Satan on more than one occasion. He fought and defeated the prince of Persia. Michael is a great warrior of God, but you cannot find any passage of scripture in the Bible where God says he will fellowship with him, or promises him anything remotely as extraordinary as he promised humans. God created the cherubim and the seraphim. They are wonderful creatures, creatures of unusual design, creatures that boggle the human imagination. Look at the description they are given in the Bible. Ezekiel 10 verse 14 and 15. And every one had four faces. The first face was the face of a cherub, and the second face was the face of a man, and the third face was the face of a lion, and the fourth the face of an eagle. And the cherubims were lifted up. This is the living creature that I saw by the river of Chebar. Yet there is no mention of God fellowshipping with any of them like God fellowship with man. They obey God's orders. Who are we for God to choose us? Why not the angels? The angels who are holy and who have never sinned? Why not them? Why not the purest of the animals? Why us humans, the same human race who messed everything up in the Garden of Eden? Why humans? Even the psalmist couldn't say. He asked, "What is man?" What did God see in a man that made him want to fellowship with him? Psalm 8 verse 4 and 5, "What is man that thou art mindful of him? And the son of man that thou visitest him? For thou hast made him a little lower than the angels, and hast crowned him with glory and honor." The man was a little lower than the angels, but yet God crowned him with glory and honor. If this doesn't make you feel important to God, then I truly don't know what will make you feel important to God. If this doesn't make you feel loved by God, then I don't know what will make you feel loved by God. The psalmist asked, "What is man? What's so special about this being that you are mindful of him? You are always thinking about mankind. What is so special about mankind?" My brothers and sisters, you have a God who is concerned about you, a God who cares, a God who loves you more than you will ever be able to understand. The Bible reveals to us time and time again people who walked with God, people who had fellowship with God, people who lived their whole life centered around the Almighty God. Now you and I can walk with God, and we can fellowship with Him. God was not left in the Old Testament. God is not only for the pastors and the prophets. No, everyone can have fellowship with God. The Garden Day Variety Saint can have fellowship with God. We can experience a life that walks with God just like Enoch did. You too can walk with God. As you travel to work, you can walk with God. You can fellowship with God. Why should I make an effort to fellowship with God? Because if you are not fellowshipping with God, who then are you fellowshipping with? This world does not care about you, and that is the truth. That is the harsh reality of this world. It does not care about you. This world does not care about you. To this world, you are just another person. You are just another social security number. But not to God. To God, you are the one who He loves. To God, you are the one who He created. the one who he breathed the breath of life into, the one who he watched when you were in your mother's womb, the one who he protected, the one who he laid down his life for. Imagine that the love God had for you was enough for him to lay down his life for you. How can you fellowship with God? Number one, pray. Pray without ceasing. Talk to God. Talk to him. I need your Lord Jesus. I need your Heavenly Father. Make time to talk to him. Fellowship in his presence. Be lost in the presence of God. Talk to him. Pray to him. The second thing you need to do to fellowship with God is to obey God always. There is no way you will fellowship with God through disobedience. That can't happen. If God tells you to do something and you object or you disobey, you are not moving with God. Check the lives of those who walked with God in the Bible. There was no disobedience in their life. Look at Enoch. He walked with God. When they say he walked with God, they weren't just talking about strolling. It means Enoch walked in obedience to God's words. He walked in love with God. He walked in respect for God. He walked with God by doing the right thing. Noah did not walk in disobedience to God. Noah walked in obedience. God told him to build an ark, and he did not hesitate. He was not even sure what the flood would look like, but he obeyed. He did not object. That was why they said Noah walked with God. Abraham was another person who obeyed God. He obeyed God to the point of sacrificing his son. He did not keep anything from God. Abraham obeyed God to the fullest. If you want to fellowship with God, do what he tells you. Those who fellowship with God are not the readers or the hearers of the word only. They are those who do what the word says. James 1 verse 22, "But be ye doers of the word, and not hearers only, deceiving your own selves." Those who fellowship with God are not those who just talk and talk, or in the name of praying. They are those who allow God to speak to them, and they listen. The third thing you need to do is not to have any other God before him. I know you will be saying you don't have any inherent gods, or you are not an idolater. Look deeper into your life. Is God in the right position in your life? Don't deceive yourself. Don't lie to yourself. Is God in the right position in your life? Do you want to fellowship with God indeed? You cannot achieve that by shifting God to the last thing in your life. Have you placed your job above God? Have you placed your boss above God? Just because of the little gift you got from someone, you have placed them above God in your life. What you now say is, if not for my boss, you ought to be thanking God for your boss. Revelation 21 verse 3 and 4. "And I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, Behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people, and God himself shall be with them, and be their God. And God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes, and there shall be no more death, neither sorrow nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things are passed away."